So, I'm delighted to introduce this next panel on social and economic engineering of the future, hopefully with a very positive connotation of engineering. And let me just briefly introduce the panelists. And so here on my left is Jessica Flack. Jessica Flack is a professor at the Santa Fe Institute who works on collective computation. So how, when many individuals come together, they produce emergent properties whereby you can treat a society almost as if it were a circuit board, and respecting, of course, the agency of the individual components. Sitting further down from her is, now not out of order, is Rob Gershaham. And Rob started his career as a book editor at Simon & Schuster, and then saw the light, and moved into virtual and augmented reality. He's worked with a huge number of very well-known companies, Prodigy Services, Scholastic, Sony, Viacom, and most interestingly, he was the director of the Institute of Play. And Rob has a very intriguing attitude towards the sort of iconoclastic treatment of discovery. And sitting by him is the great writer, Cory Doctorow. Yay. And Cory is many things. Cory is an activist. He's someone who's thought extremely deeply about the modern world in which we live, the open source movement, the control and dissemination of information. And his novels and books and blog posts and so on reflect those interests. Most recently, his wonderful novel, Walk Away, which means, yes, you can, I guess. But including in real life an information doesn't want to be free, which is a twist on a famous false remark. And sitting next to him is the wonderful, the inimitable, the only, the extraordinary D.A. Wallach, who you've met, of course, introducing some of these sessions. D.A. Is hard to describe. He started off learning, I don't know, he speaks several languages, he spent a lot of time in Africa, working with a number of different communities, then became a rock musician, appears in the film La La Land, and for some reason, something happened to DA, and he's a venture capitalist. I don't know, man, you have to explain yourself. But he's doing venture capital for good and has become an extraordinary expert in molecular biology, nanotech, and the interface between those principles and inference and machine learning. So it's an amazing panel. Take it away, Jess.
Okay. Well, welcome, everybody. I hope you're having a good time in InterPlanetary. So what I want to do is start just with a few minutes, like 2 or 3 minutes of context to ground the discussion. And the first thing I want to say is that human history is actually replete with examples of attempts to orchestrate social outcomes and to engineer social interactions. And a great example comes from New Mexico itself, from Chaco Canyon. Another example is the Balinese water temple system that emerged in the 9th century in Southeast Asia. And there you have amazing, iconic, stylized monuments and the evolution of all sorts of elaborate rituals to control planting cycles and water distribution. Another example, a very different kind of example, is, of course, voting systems. A really interesting one comes from Venice. It was a voting protocol, incredibly opaque, Rube Goldberg-like voting protocol that was invented by these feuding Venetian families in the 1500s to make the election of the Doge tamper-free. So these are all examples of what I would call social engineering, but of course, if you are an actual engineer, you might balk at that definition or balk at those examples. Because social engineering is not particularly precise. It certainly hasn't been. And it's not at all like designing a cell phone tower or a spaceship or a car or grain for milling, a water wheel for milling grain. You know, it's very different. There's no meticulously drawn blueprints. There are no objective tests that we can use to decide whether a particular social intervention is actually going to work to change things. And in fact, it's largely been based on human intuition about cause and effect. And then based on our understanding of what those cause and effects are, trying to manipulate them to change things. So for example, if crime goes up, we build more prisons and increase our police force, right? So it's kind of post hoc, retro, looking back, and based on intuition. And so you could say that so far in human history, social engineering has been what we call, or what I have called in our work, largely reactive instead of proactive, right? And the reason for that, one of the reasons that this has been the case is because we haven't really had fantastic, fine-grained data on individual behavior. But as you all know, as you have gained a glimmer of, no doubt, with the Cambridge Analytica Facebook debacles, that is beginning to change. It's not clear how it will change yet, but it is definitely beginning to change. And we are getting, for the first time in human history, incredibly detailed data on human social interactions. We're getting great data on humans in groups, and we're getting data on how collective decisions are made. So the world is about to change, I would say. And the question is, now with this digital technology and that great data, are we in a position to maybe engineer social outcomes from the bottom up with quantitative principles? And this is an important concept, one that we can certainly employ on Earth now, and maybe take off Earth as we explore new worlds. And the question is, given that we have this opportunity, maybe the time has come to really think hard about it, to think outside the box, to think about how what we could do, what would be possible if we weren't limited by our own imaginations. So that's what we're going to talk a little bit about today. And before we jump into the discussion, these guys, I think, are just going to say a minute or two about their own backgrounds and their maybe make a provocative statement or give their perspective on this issue. So why don't we just go down the line?
Okay. Can you all hear me? Okay. So as David said, I was working in the book industry and then saw the light into digital technology, and specifically games. And for many years, I was interested in games as sort of an emerging art form, essentially a form of fiction. But the past 15 years, it's been clear to me that they are a form of social experimentation, especially as games became social connected. And so they become, for me, an interesting way to sort of do social engineering, but social understanding, and at different timescales. So while we may have the real-time world of Cambridge Analytica, it's possible to do experimentation, to think of game-like environments as terraria for exploring the future. So that's of great interest to me.
So I'm a science fiction novelist, and that means that I often think about predictive power of different kinds of imaginative exercises. And I have the conclusion that science fiction has virtually no predictive power. I think science fiction writers are basically Texas marksmen. We like to fire a shotgun into the side of a barn and then draw a target around the place where our pellets went in and then tell everyone what a great shot we are. But science fiction does some other interesting and useful things. It's kind of obvious on its face that science fiction is a really good inspiration or warning. You know, all appearances to the contrary, George Orwell did not intend 1984 to be a manual for statecraft. You know, it was meant to be something of a warning. People get inspired. Paul Krugman became an economist because he thought Harry Seldon and Asimov's books seemed like a cool dude. But that warning and inspiration is itself, I think, just sort of the first-order effect. The more interesting second-order effect is the diagnostic power of science fiction. So if you want to know what a science fiction writer is secretly worried about or hopeful for, read what they've written. If you want to know what the world is secretly hopeful for or fearing, read what they're reading. You know, find out what's on the bestseller list. Mary Shelley's book is 200 years old, and we're still reading it. We're reading it probably for different reasons than they read Frankenstein 200 years ago. But the fact that we're now really worried about runaway technology becoming our master instead of our servant tells you a lot about where we are today. And so I'm interested in what are futuristic stories about social control say about our beliefs about human behavior and where we're going and where we're coming from.
Since David framed my transition to venture capital investing as a little paradoxical, I guess I'll just defend it for a second, and maybe that's a good way to explain myself. Broadly speaking, if you're investing other people's money, the goal is to give them more money back than they gave you. And I tend to think that there are two ways of doing this. One is you either identify things in the world that you think are extremely unlikely to change, and you place bets on those things, and that's probably the best way to reliably make money. And then the second is to make predictions about what things, if they existed, people would spend a lot of their money on. And that is, I think, inherently a project of social engineering. So the companies that I try to back are companies that have a new idea about how we should do something, and they're either vindicated or discredited when they actually give people the option to say yes or no to that experience. Over time, of course, my hope is to get better and better at predicting this, but the more I've done it, the more obvious it becomes that it's a really difficult thing to do. Predicting in general is really hard, and as Jessica said, social engineering is extremely imprecise. However, I guess what gives me hope is that all of these changes in human behavior tend to begin with some act of creativity, whether that's the proposal of a new scientific theory or an explanation of something, or by creating an experience that people can participate in and then choose to. And it just doesn't happen unless people give it a shot. So there needs to be a source of new ideas. And for those new ideas to become important in our society, driven as it is so much by economic activity, those have to be ideas that people can participate in economically.
All right, awesome, guys. So let's actually dive into that a little bit and think about this question of limits. I think one question we might ask is, are the current social institutions that we have, are they the best there is, the ones that we've seen over human history, for example, or are they a consequence of the sort of constraints that actually Earth has placed on us, natural ecology and so forth, our brains maybe, and to what extent are they also the limits of our imagination?
So I'll go first. I feel like it's probably self-evident that they're probably not the best that there ever will be. They're defined by conditions here, past and present. And when we talk about social engineering as a distributed interplanetary society, there are going to be new conditions. The question is, will we reflexively seek to impose old models on new conditions in a context where the cost of failure is very high, where these settlements and fragile environments will collapse if it's wrong?
So there's this sort of trade-off between doing what you know works,
right,
and being exploratory. And of course, you sort of know that what works might work for our brains, for example, in the way sort of that we interact with each other, but maybe not in a new ecology.
Right.
So how do you balance that? I mean, especially when the cost, like you say, if we go to Mars or something, is really high of getting it wrong.
Right.
Well, you know, I think that when we think about engineering problems, we can cleave them into two halves. One is whether we've designed a system that works well, and one is whether we've designed a system that fails gracefully. Mm-hmm. And when you say something best or worst, or is it as good as it can be, and what are its constraints? I mean, a system that works very well but fails to adapt to changing circumstances its lack of graceful failure is probably like a deal breaker, right? Because, you know, it doesn't matter how much general prosperity you produce during the golden years if you are all drinking your urine and digging through rubble looking for canned goods in 10 years, right? Like, mm-hmm. you kind of want a soft landing as well as a great voyage on the way. My concern about any or all of the ways that we contemplate off-planet civilizations or off-planet societies is that they all seem to have these authoritarian underpinnings. You know, either they're conceived of in an explicitly military construct. We have words like captain as part of the kind of construct, and you see this in Heinlein and other science fiction of the age, where oftentimes there's someone who's like literally wearing a sidearm and shouting, "It's lifeboat rules!" whenever anyone questions their authority, like, because we're all in a lifeboat, we don't know how much longer we've got, I'm the only one who knows how to steer the lifeboat, you do what you're told or I shoot you and toss you overboard. And, you know, whether or not there are times in a lifeboat where you need to do that, for a certain kind of person, sinking the ship so that you all get in the lifeboat and you get to shout lifeboat rules whenever anyone disagrees with you might be an awfully attractive proposition. Or, you know, we're talking about, you know, Iron Man sending us all to Mars in our Teslas. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that is a guy who, by all accounts, is the world's shittiest boss. And, like, the idea that we'll just all subject ourselves to his management style, it's, you know, it's a kind of, like, off-world, no-escape Sartrean vision of the original vision for Disney World, where you'd have a dome and everyone would live there and Walt Disney would replace the Bill of Rights with a set of employment terms that would involve not swearing, not having a mustache, you know, like, all of his kind of, everyone has to drink Tom Collins instead of Caprinos or something, you know, like, those kind of weird aesthetic ideas that rich weirdos come up with and declare to be natural laws.
So part of this, I guess, is having a kind of fluid organizational structure. So I think we had some discussions with NASA once where they were talking about actually the problem of getting to Mars over 10 months. And part of it is, you know, a standard kind of NASA mission where you need that command style organization that they drew from the military. But part of it's a science expedition. Yeah. And they need to be able to shift in us, you know, in over those 10 months between these two very different organizational structures. And so how do you design that? What kind of team is the right team that can go between these two very different states?
I mean, I think a really interesting real-world example of social engineering is the American Civil Rights Movement, which over decades navigated between a number of different organizational structures. So you had grassroots, you know, decades-long legal campaigns going on to try and elucidate the ways in which the law was being misinterpreted to produce social outcomes that were obviously unjust to the people who were critiquing them. You also had sort of galvanizing leadership in the form of folks like Martin Luther King or Malcolm X or others who appeared to be almost dictatorial figures, but who stood on the shoulders of thousands of grassroots volunteers who were actually changing people's perceptions.
Right.
And the other thing that I think is really interesting about the civil rights movement or the suffragette movement, you can talk about movements elsewhere in the world, is that they were efforts at social engineering that didn't begin from some idealist vision of the future. They began from a place of identifying obvious problems and injustice. And when I look out at the world, I think there are so many things that are obviously mistaken in the way we do things that, given our limited time, better to start with those. Let's triage the things that we know don't work and just make them a little bit better, at least. I think where we often in the past, as we have thought about ourselves as doing social engineering, have erred is by saying, you know, throw out everything. And we have some picture in some guy's book of exactly what it should look like.
That's a nice example, DA. But let me tell me a little bit more about it, because what it sounds like is that, of course, there wasn't a big vision for the civil rights movement that was conceived at the beginning. It was these personalities and aspects that sort of filled a niche that developed as the civil rights movement grew. And so it's reactive in the sense that I was suggesting in the introduction, like many of the examples that we have. Instead of proactive, and there's an idea in evolution called niche construction, where basically organisms, humans included, go out and modify the environment. They change the selection pressures they're subject to, and therefore they sort of control the future and can predict the future a little more. It's very proactive. Are there any elements that we can take from the like civil rights example that have that kind of proactive feature?
Well, I think you get into causality in some sense, because the question is, if you twist this knob in the society, what happens? You know, there are certain laws that are obviously pretty clearly connected to their outcomes. So if, for example, you have a law that prohibits black people from voting, you can be relatively confident that more black people will vote if you make it legal for them to do so. And so, you know, I think you start with that kind of low-hanging fruit, and then it gets more complicated when you get into issues that currently surround issues of racial justice in America, for example, around what different sentencing laws will do in the way of outcomes in a specific neighborhood where, you know, the product may be the result of a lot of different processes that's just one part of.
I think maybe the distinction that you guys are trying to work to is tactics and strategy, right? I mean, I think that there was a vision, right? You know, MLK was a socialist who believed in a kind of egalitarian outcome. That was the thing he was headed towards. This is the thing that the long arc of history is bending towards, in his view. And then he has a bunch of tactical ideas for how to accomplish it, as do his colleagues. And I think that this is where, like, our discussions about, well, do we want a decentralized or a centralized system sometimes break down, because the answer is, for what, right? You know, we want, when the principles elucidated in the Constitution serve us well for achieving whatever goal it is we want, then we're all strict constitutionalists. When we're worried about the Three-Fifths Compromise, the Constitution is an unfit document that needs to be revised from time to time in order to improve it. You know, it's the obvious one is, Democrats love executive authority when there's a Democrat in the White House, and they love states' rights when there's a Republican in the White House, and they hate states' rights when states are passing voter suppression laws, and they love states' rights when states are preserving Obamacare and mandating net neutrality.
Yes,
right? But the way to resolve that conundrum is not to say, well, you have an ideological incoherence as to whether you like states or the central government making your rule. The ideological coherence is, I want net neutrality or universal healthcare or socialism or universal justice, and whatever tool in the moment serves that is the tool I want to use. And if my adversary can use it to weaken my goals, right? The reason we have the rules of the game is to produce an outcome that we want, not because we want to have a fun game, and maybe that's the difference between games as a kind of purely ludic exercise. Although you sometimes get this, like, you know, people who play pool like jerks, right, who just go all in on every hand in order to intimidate everyone else. You know, those people, like, if you're at the table, or not pool, poker, if you're at the table, you're like, dude, it's a friendly game, and you're ruining it, right? And they're like, well, it's in the rules. Everyone hates those people.
Right. It seems to me there are three, so I think about this, there are almost three domains that have different possible considerations for a social engineering piece. And one is kind of why we're here today, which is how do we actually re-energize and galvanize society to value the whole question of we as a species becoming interplanetary? Mm-hmm. And that's one set of activities which I think is really interesting and at hand. The second one is sort of what I'd call the intermediate phase, which is the journey out, right? And there where you get into the captain's rule, the lifeboat rules, you know, where it's still very fragile, still exploratory. And then the third phase is, okay, things are more or less established. And now what are the relationships of those societies? It's interesting we call them colonies. That has an implicit colonial meaning. Let's just call them settlement societies, something else. And what is their relationship to the mothership now? And that's really the complex, interesting, and probably conflict-ridden future.
I think you skipped a step, because you started with, we all want to unite as a species to get off planet. But I think there's at least two camps. One is, we all need to get off this planet before we use it up, because we can't possibly not use it all up. Right. And if we use it all up in the process of getting off the planet, at least we got off the planet before we used it up, which is a certain circularity to it.
Right.
Right? And then there's the, like, well, we need to get off this planet so that we can learn to be better stewards of our own planet. And, like, that eventual relationship is in large part dictated by why we go.
Yeah.
Let me push back a little bit. So, two things are different about the future, right? One is what I said in the introduction, and that is that we have at our disposal potentially incredible data that we've just not had before, so we could have quantitative principles guiding our social engineering. And the other is that we will be going off planet, right? These are two big things, right? And so you guys are presenting a very coherent sort of picture of the things that we might take into account, the steps we might pass through. But again, there's this question of, are we really challenging ourselves? What are the limits of our imagination? Should we have that discussion? How can we identify what those limits might be? What are strategies we can use to reveal these biases?
Good question.
Put you on the spot.
Well, I actually think this morning's panel on living in space was a good peek at some of the things that have to be considered. You know, Antarctic missions where strangers are in close quarters. You know, it's just one example. So I think there's a lot of rehearsal that can happen here to suss out at least
counterfactuals.
Yeah, and suss out part of the things. The desire to I forget how it was said, but let's make sure we transmit the data back from these expeditions on Earth. Or if it's a SEAL team or whatever, that we capture that data so that experiential knowledge can be transmitted in a meaningful and quantitative way. I think that's a way to start. I don't know if that gets at the question.
Well, what about video games?
And video games are a way to approximate certain types of things, absolutely. I mean, a famous simple example that's roughly in the domain is the pandemic in World of Warcraft, where a virus was introduced and behaviors could be observed. And so games are a very data-rich environment. And so that's why I brought it up in the first place. Not so much because of the gameplay, but because of the data that's generated and available.
I mean, I guess one of the questions you've raised, Jessica, is whether we should embrace the possibilities afforded to us by the sensorization of the world and our higher fidelity ability to measure what's going on. And, you know, I think there's some debate among people who think about this stuff, maybe you're one of them, as to whether or not these sort of systems are even in theory modelable and interrogable in an empirical way.
Absolutely.
I would like to bet that they are, because most other things that we've tried to measure have turned out to be.
That's SFI.
That's SFI. I think what's important, though, and maybe missing, particularly in the Silicon Valley world that I sort of inhabit, is a level of humility about how quickly and completely we learn and understand things and what it does mean to understand something. And, you know, we were talking before the panel, there's a history of science and politics is littered with misunderstandings that we essentially overreacted to. And so, you know, we believe in things like phrenology or other, you know,
eugenics.
Now silly ideas, eugenics. Mm-hmm. And then we invest so deeply in them, and we try to build our world around them. So we should have some sort of provisional holding period that we subject new knowledge to. When we think we've figured out how something works, we could start doing some fun, you know, sort of skunk works projects with it, but we shouldn't immediately vote out every president in the world and ask for new people to implement the crazy brand new theory. Which, you know, is sort of inherently a bit conservative, but I think it's conservative in the right way. It's a question of what does modesty look like as a governing principle for our civilization?
Can I propose that we actually do have a model for a civilization in which people have to live for a very long time in close quarters with limited contact with the outside under very strict rules? It's prisons. Right? They're fully surveilled. We have tons of data about them. We're not very good at predicting how prisoners will behave. It turns out that human behavior is like super adversarial. The people who want to influence or control or persuade people to behave in a certain way need to contend, first of all, with people who a second power block or multiple power blocks that want the same people to behave in a different way. I want the voters to vote for me, and you want the voters to vote for you. And then there's the voters, right, who themselves are adapting and thinking and have their own set of priorities. And one of the things that we know about persuasion and other forms of social engineering is that it's dynamic, and that tactics that worked stalemate really quick, mm-hmm. right? I was saying before, if you go around Santa Fe, you'll see on the sides of the old brick buildings signs, you know, ghost ads, buy Pear soap, 5 cents, it will make you clean. And there was a time when apparently that sold soap, right? And now it's like, Axe body spray will make you a love god. Because, like, we developed a callus over the part in our attention or mm-hmm. our persuadability that where it will make you clean seemed like, well, they wouldn't say it would make you clean if it wasn't true. They wouldn't let them put it on a building if it wasn't true, certainly. You know. And now we're like, well, it's probably a lie, right? And so, you know, we see this with all persuasion techniques. Even if we stipulate that Cambridge Analytica's marketing material should be taken at face value, and they are in fact Svengalis who can make you believe that up is down and black is white, and that they were making normal people into racists instead of just finding racists and making them into voters. Even if you believe that that's the case, there's no reason to believe that they can do it again next year, mm-hmm. right? Maybe it's a one-off.
I don't know if it's a one-off, but it's certainly early days.
Right.
Certainly early days. I mean, okay, so maybe one more set of issues before we take a question or two. Is it naive to think that in settling, say, another planet, that we'll essentially have the opportunity to really start over? Is that naive, or, I mean, are there reasons to believe that these will be very isolated settlements? And where there'll be memory, of course, of human history and human institutions, but it will decay.
I think it will decay over time. I think it really depends on how sort of communication is preserved mm-hmm. between Earth-based societies and other societies. And that's still very problematic and to be determined.
You know, I think that we wouldn't want it to not decay in as much as we'd want it to be dynamic, because its circumstances would change, right? You know, they're not like LARPing day one of the colony for the next 1,000 years, right? They, like, if there's other people on other planets and new technologies and new social movements and pandemics and whatever, you know, they're going to have to adapt. So, you know, I think that it's instructive to look to the project of framing the U.S. Constitution, where you have these radicals who wanted to create a static system that would still flex a little, right? We want to radically tear down everything. We want to set up a set of principles. They should never change, except very slowly and incrementally through these things like constitutional conventions. So they were pretty damn sure of themselves.
And it had a big impact, actually. Cultural history of the Constitution is very influential.
Yeah, yeah. And it's like it's a thing that a lot of people do when they constitutionalize. And you see people trying with various success to try and do it with free software projects or online communities. it almost never happens in games. Right. You know, games have this like problem that they're, unless we're talking about an old school MUD, they're super authoritarian. Right. You know, in the same way that jokes are authoritarian, you don't get to vote on when the punchline gets told. In a game, you don't get to vote on when the dungeon master puts the orc in front of you. Like, that's the dungeon master's job is to, your job is to like decide which dungeon master you want, and their job is to tell you where the orcs are. And so, you know, games are like super anti-democratic in that way.
I think it would be really dumb for us to start fresh. And the reason for that is that we've come up with a lot of cool stuff. And we also have a lot of evidence about the
like
things
the
that we can do. So you put us in certain circumstances, and unfortunately we can all, it seems, turn into Nazis. You put us in other circumstances, and it turns out we can sing Kumbaya and hug each other and worship the Rajneesh. And so I think, like, we think of technology as gizmos and gadgets, but it, of course, encompasses everything that we do and the ideas that we have and social norms. And those things serve to sort of put us in a cage to ensure a certain amount of good behavior and limit bad behavior, but also hopefully not so restrictive a cage that we can't flourish as people or as societies or create new ideas. And I think that general framework of wanting to keep ourselves from being bad but allow ourselves to explore and invent should also govern the way that we would move anywhere else. I think it would be terrible if we saw that as the beginning of history.
Okay, awesome. Maybe you have time for one question. Yeah.
Do you want to rephrase it, Jessica, so the
question,
audience?
Yeah, do you want to?
So I think it's a criticism of both capitalism and communism. Is that correct? And you want a better system? Oh, wait for the train to go by. A better system in which workers get out what they put in. That's more maybe emphasizes equality more, equality of effort.
So look, I think everybody wants to declare what they've done to be a unique act of creation and that all the things that they used to do it to be mere plumbing that anyone could have come up with. I don't know that you could ever calculate the part that the worker did or the part, you know, that any one individual put in. This is the problem with measurement is that it pretends that it's measuring all the important things. And generally what it measures is the thing that the person who's doing the measuring is pretty good at because that's the number they want to look that they want to make big and reify. When we're talking about performance measurement, you know, you know, the reason we allocate resources at all is because we don't have enough. Having enough, we talked earlier when we were planning this about scarcity and abundance, having enough is a matter of making things very well, which we're getting very good at, choosing what we want, which we're less good at, and then distributing what we have, which we're really, really bad at. And it may be that if we fix one of those other two things, all of the questions about fair allocation go away. We don't worry about fair allocation of air, right? We don't worry about fair allocation of, well, now we're worrying about fair allocation of sex, right? This is a kind of weird thing that happens when you start to complain about, when you make allocation the big question, is you start to say, well, why can't I buy a kidney? How come some people get to have sex and other people don't? Why can't rude, obnoxious, and objectionable people have sex? You know, like this is this. There's now a terrorist movement grounded in this that just killed 10 people in Toronto. You know, so I don't know that allocation and fair shares are the right thing. Maybe abundance is the right thing.
I would just say because we discussed it before the panel. Cory brought up I don't know if you were quoting him, but the philosopher Slavoj Zizek says this thing that for us to sort of illustrate how ideology laid in our minds are, that it's more sort of easy to envision the end of the universe than the end of capitalism. And I guess when you think about these two systems opposed to each other, as you did in the question, what maybe we forget is that the future almost certainly is going to be characterized by new ideas that don't yet exist. And as a technologist or as an investor, I'm always looking for the fountains of those new ideas. I think at least for this crowd, since we're in America right now, it's important to recognize that China is producing right now some phenomenally interesting and new ideas, some of which are terrifying and some of which are just sort of like, huh. And they view themselves as instantiating socialism, quote unquote, with a Chinese character, which, to sort of Jessica's framing comments, involves a granularization of the way that workers are measured and people's behaviors in the society are tracked and rewarded or punished. And so whether we want to bring that into reality or not, they are. And I think it's incumbent upon those of us in the West or in traditions that prioritize the individual in a way that China, say, doesn't, respond with equally new ideas that speak to the deficiencies of our traditions and offer a counterpoint to the proposals that they're making to the rest of society.
All right, excellent. Guys, thank you so
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.